living God. I call him. Amen. Amen. He's living, all right, because I'm alive too. And he's the one that caused me to be alive. Amen. We know that he has all power in heaven and earth. If the devil had power, why is the sun still shining? He got no power. Rainfall, you can't stop none of that. Can't stop none of that. Devil can't stop none of that. From these past week, the pastor been teaching us how to wait on God and know this time while we are waiting, you know, there's something we have to do. Amen. And I was looking at it real good in the time, the space wise. What do you do in the space while you know you're waiting for God? You know, what do you do? Look at Psalms 27 and 14. It says, wait what? David was a man after God's own heart who has been through much struggle, much problem, hiding in caves. I mean, he had it real bad. I mean, the devil was after him, working against him on every side. But David had words of encouragement to us. Psalm 27 and 14. He says, the last verse, he says, wait. That's the whole thing, is to wait on God. Because he's the only one that has the answer. Amen? If you notice this world, they too have to wait. Amen? They too got to wait. They got to wait too. Some of them wait with their five senses, and some, they ain't got no time to wait, so they do stupid things. But the Bible tells us we got to wait on God because he has the answer. They have no answer. Your five senses is not the answer. Ain't no good answer. Not going to work. But David says, wait for the Lord. That's who you're waiting on. He has power in his hand. He's the one to answer your prayer. He says, be strong. You got to be strong. Amen. You got to be strong. You got to muster up that strength. Amen. Know that God is faithful. He will never let you down. Let your heart take courage. Because his words are living word. Amen. His words are powerful words. Amen. Yes. Wait for the Lord. God gonna bless you, saints. Because he says, I was young. David says, and now I'm old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, no seed being bred. And that's the truth. I was young and I'm getting older, but I see those saints. I never begged bread. Lord, always see me through. If it's even one meal, thank be to God for the one meal. Amen. Never let me go hungry. So, saints, I'm a living testimony of that too. God will bless you. Just wait. Everything's going to be all right. Just wind down that devil. Just wind down with faith. Faith will slow him down. But he ain't got no faith, he going to hasty step on you. So wind him down with some faith. Hold up your shield of faith and push him back. Because he can't come forward while you have the shield of faith. Faith will push him back. Amen? Look at Psalm 62. This is David here. While we're going through, while we're waiting on God, David, I look at David. Because David's been through a lot of stuff. And the Bible says, all this was written for our learning. Amen. That we might have hope. David says in Psalm 62, verse 8 and verse 11, them two verses right there. Verse 8, he says, trust in him at all times. That's what David did. So why I can't do the same thing? I'm going to trust God all times. Amen. Oh, people, this is the key. Pull out your what? That's what David did in the cave. He cried to God. He weeping and mourning, cried to God while he's waiting. Because when we pray, And when we praise God, we're shutting out the devil from yapping our ears. Because if he's yapping and you're praying and praising, it can't affect your thought. But if you stand still and don't do nothing, don't say nothing, that devil gonna speak louder to you. But when you praise God and pray, his noises bounce back on him. Bounce back. It's not affecting you. That's why it says in the Bible, man to always pray and faint not. Rejoice forevermore. Because when you rejoice and pray, the devil, words of lie and deception cannot affect you. But if you sit back and do nothing, he's going to bombard you. He's going to hit you. He's going to say everything to hit your flesh. Because your flesh going to cry out. That's the first thing going to cry out, your flesh. Because the flesh is weak. That's the first thing going to give up. Well, you keep praising God. You keep praying. It bounced back to him. He got to find somewhere to come around to hit you. And he ain't got nothing new. Always old stuff. Amen? So he said, trust in him at all times. All people, pour out your heart before him. Amen? Pray, cry out to him. God is a what? Why ain't you waiting time for God? He's your refuge, saints. He's your hiding place. He's that rock, that solid rock. He ain't going nowhere. The Bible says he filled the heaven and earth. He inhabited eternity. You can't hide from God. Nothing can hide from God. Where shall I go, he said. David, if I was to go up, he's there. If I go down in hell, he's there. Where going to go? Amen. Verse 11. This is what I love. Is this what I love? Once God has spoken, no man can remove his word. Twice have I heard this, that power belongs to God. Who else has power? Talk to me. Who else has power in this universe? Look, you see the stars and the moon. Who created all these things? God did it for himself, by himself. God alone has power. Verse 12. And loving kindness is yours, O Lord, for you recompense a man according to his work. So if you walk by faith, God gonna bless you. If you don't walk by faith, what you sow, you reap. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 3, 5 through 10. This is Solomon, too, was a king. And he needed help from God. And this is what he's saying to us this morning, that are waiting on God, that are hoping and trusting God. This is what he says, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 8, trust in the Lord with all your what? God don't want a part of your heart. He wants all of it. God gave up all, so he wants all from you. He gave up his only begotten son, everything he gave up. So he wants all from you. He don't want a piece. He wants all of you. Amen? And do not lean to your own what? Don't lean to your flesh. Because Jesus told us, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Can't lean on that. That cries out every time it feels a little tingling. Oh, cries out for everything that go wrong. Next verse. In all your ways, acknowledge him. Pray. And he will make your path straight. Amen. Next verse. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Like Adam and Eve, get wise in your own eyes. I think if I eat this fruit, I will become like God. Yeah? What did it do to them? They lose their blessings and was cursed. Because she was wise in her own eyes and her husband was blinded by her and hate of the fruit. Because the Bible says he was with her while anyone was talking. And he didn't do anything. Just stand there and says, wife, you know what? What you eat, I'm going to eat. He didn't take a stand. You got to take a stand, saints. Fear the Lord and turn away from what? The Bible says anything that is not of faith is what? Sin. So we got to live by faith. Amen? Next verse. It will be healing to your body and refreshing to your bone. Next verse. Honor the Lord from your wealth and from the first of all your produce, fruits, your blessing. Honor the Lord with it. Bless him with it. Because God promised to press down, shaken, and running over, put into your bosom. Not into your hands, into your bosom. Amen. Next verse. So your barns will be filled with plenty and your vat will overflow with new wine. Look what God want to do for us. Well, to bless us. Amen? So stay faithful. Amen? Let's go to Philippians 4:8. This is what we do while we're waiting for God to bless us. Philippians 4:8. Finally, brethren, watch your things are what? What's your thing are good of? If there's any what? If any worthy of praise, dwell on what? That's what we do while we wait on God. This is the answer. What are we going to do? Sit down and cry and mope and weep, oh me, oh my? That ain't going to help. But what we do that, that's what's going to help. And this is the key here to all of that stuff there. Let's go to 1 Timothy 4:15. 1 Timothy 4:15. This is Paul speaking to a young man, young pastor, and tell him, take what? With these things. Be absorbed with them. Let them sink into your spirit, soul. He said to you, meditate on these things. Just don't let it fly over your head. Sit down and like a sheep, cow, and they would eat the grass, and they go and find themselves a tree, and they will bring it up back and chew on that thing all day. Bring it up. That's what we got to do like the cow. Bring up the word of God. Meditate. Let it sink into your spirit. Let it take root in your soul. And then it will bring some fruit. It will bring some joy. It will bring some peace. You got to meditate on these things, saints. We got to stir them up. So that your what? Progress will be what? Evident to all. Fruit will show up. Somebody say, man, that man is praying. That man is waiting on God. Because they are going to see the joy of the Lord. They're going to see result. They're going to see progress. That God is with you. Saints, encourage you this morning. Don't let the enemy trick you, man. Just hold on, man. It ain't going to last too long. The flesh going to tell you, man, it's too long. Yeah, but look at them guys. This lady, for 12 years, she had an issue of blood in her body. And she spent all her money on the physician. But she kept on waiting. Kept on seeking. One day, she heard about a man, Christ Jesus. Hot day, miserable day. My God, can you understand that woman? I haven't been there, but you all ladies know that. Pain, excruciating, and she got down on her knees because she couldn't see Jesus. Because the crowd was so thick. That's what faith will do to you, man. Put you on your knees. Because I need help now. That woman, faith, put her down on her knees and said, if I could just touch the hem, that's all I want to do. If I can get a touch, I know everything will be all right. All these men was around her. And in those times, a woman with issue of blood not supposed to be in a crowd of men. She was seen as an outcast. But she didn't care what people think. You can't let what people think hurt you and stop your blessing. She humbled herself, submitted herself, and go between some dusty old feet. Some old robe ain't washed for days. Dust. And press her way through. Got her deliverance. Got her healing. But took her some humbling. And there was another one I liked too. This lady, for 38 years, she was like this. Can you imagine 30 years like this? I can't see the stars. I ain't see the sun. I can't look up to the moon at night. 38 years. That's miserable. That woman kept on hoping and trusting in a hope. One day she met Jesus. And Jesus stood upright. She stood upright when Jesus touched her. And there's another man. I know he had to crawl to the pool of Silo. Because if he had someone to help him, they would have stayed there and plop him in. But he had to wait at the pool. And the Lord met him. And he says, Lord, I have no one to put me in. But thank be to God, there was somebody there to touch him. This mighty man, what manner of man is this? His disciples said, even the wind and the sea obey him. What awesome. God is awesome, saints. And our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Oh, my God, saints. Let us wait. It's good to wait. You ain't going to lose. It's a win-win right here. God be the glory. Great things he's going to do in your life if you just wait. Be patient. Be faithful. God will see you through, saints. I know he will because I'm a testimony to that. I've been through some tough times, saints. I mean, me and Emma, I suppose, again, tell some tough time that we've been through. God, see, back in where I'm from, there's no welfare check. Nothing but family and friends. That's all we got. No welfare check, no government coming in. You better make sure you can hustle. But the saints of God, they back home where I'm from, they pray. They pray. They see God. They keep in touch with God. If it's even one meal for the day, they praise God for it. I had to walk for miles to go to church. I didn't have no wheels. And my wheels were my 2 feet. Get me there. I was glad to be there. And I left rejoicing. Saints, hold on. Trouble don't last always, man. But if you're strong in the spirit, you will last. You be blessed in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah. If you receive the word of faith, won't you give God a hand clap of praise for just a moment? Father, we thank you for your word, Lord God, which brings faith, Lord. We thank you for your word, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We receive your word, Lord God. We receive your word, Lord, for faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Saints, I thank God for the preaching of faith. Amen. We've been hearing a lot of preaching of faith because faith is important. Amen. You're not going to make it unless you have faith. And I thank God for Elder Waldron for being a preacher of faith and sharing the word of faith this morning. Amen. How many of you believe today? That's why we're here, right? Because we believe. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Amen. That's what faith is. Faith is when you hear by the word of God. You understand what I'm saying? Not just hearing the word of God, but hearing by the word of God. I mean, it's like it's the way that verse is written, it's almost written like the word of God is a filter that you hear by. Hearing by the word of God. Like when you put glasses on, glasses help what you see. Amen. When you receive the word helps what you hear, because you start to hear by the word of God. Someone could tell you one thing, but when what they're telling you runs through the filter of faith, it winds up sounding a lot different. You got to hear by the word of God. Amen. That's why we walk in faith. We believe the word. We trust the word and allow the word to filter what we allow in our heart. Amen. Whose report will you believe? That's what it comes down to. Faith causes you to only believe the report of God. That's why we hear by the word of God. Amen. I thank God for his word this morning. If you could turn with me to the book of Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7 and verse 9. Amen. How many of you glad to be in God's house, amongst God's people, in God's presence, to hear God's word? Amen. The theme is it's all about God. God's people, God's presence, God's word. Amen. We're here because of our faith in God. Amen. Revelation chapter 7. We're going to start at verse 9 this morning.
After these things, I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could count.
Somebody say, a lot of people. I looked and beheld a great multitude which no one could count. Notice this.
From every nation and all tribes.
From every nation. All. Somebody say everybody. Amen. If you're racist, you ain't going to make it here. Amen. Every nation, every tribe. All right.
And peoples.
Peoples.
And tongues. So
different languages. It's as diverse as it gets. Amen. But God is powerful enough to do this when we submit to faith in him and faith in his son, Jesus Christ. This is what God desires. To save all of his creation, regardless of where we're from, what language we speak. God desires that we all make it. Amen. It's not his will that any should perish, but that all should come to everlasting life. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
Standing before the throne and before the Lamb.
Standing before the throne and
before the Lamb.
Oh, God. We're going to have to teach a series called Verses Your Pastor Hates to Bring Up in Church. Yeah. Amen. Because so many people shy away from certain passages because they fear that if they read them, the church is going to get a wrong understanding of who God is. Well, if you fear reading certain passages, it's probably because you have the wrong understanding of who God is. Amen. Amen. If you open the book and you start from 1 Timothy chapter 1, but you don't read the first four verses. You start at verse 5 because you're scared to say grace and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. It's because you're teaching it wrong. Amen. Give it to me one more time, Bishop. Notice this.
Standing before the throne and before the Lamb.
Before God and before Jesus. Hallelujah. Keep coming, Bishop. Notice this.
Clothed in white robes and palm branches were in their hands.
Somebody say righteous. All right.
And they cry out with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.
Well, if you don't like this language, you're not going to feel comfortable in heaven. Amen? If you can't talk like this, you don't have heavenly language. You don't have the language that the apostles use. Because the apostles often and always referred to God and Christ. That's not two natures. That's one God and one Messiah. All right, I don't even want to talk about that today. But I kind of do want to talk about it. You understand that this is more than just two natures in one being, right? We understand that this is God and his Messiah, that there was an intimate relationship between God and the Messiah. The Messiah had to be surrendered to the will of God, prayed to God, had his own mind, didn't know all things, right? Because he said, no man knoweth the day or the hour, neither the angels nor the Son of Man, referring to himself, but only my Father which is in heaven. You're talking about two minds, one all-knowing and one who had to be taught. Two lives, right? Because John 5 and 26 says, even as the Father had life in himself, so has he given to the Son to have life in himself. Therefore, one could die and one could remain alive. That's why it was necessary that there be two lives, because somebody had to pay the price and God can't die. Amen? Keep coming for me. Somebody say God and the Lamb. Amen. Keep coming, Bishop. Notice this.
And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Notice this.
Then one of the elders answered, saying to me, these who are clothed in the white robes, who are they? And where have they come from?
Amen.
And I said to him, my Lord, you know. And he said to me, these are the ones who come out of the great tribulation, and they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
For this reason, they are before the throne of God.
Notice this. They came out of great what?
Tribulation.
So notice, even though the saints will be here when tribulation breaks out, amen, God's still powerful enough to get you out of there alive and get you out of there saved and in your right mind. This group of people that he's seeing are those who remained faithful to God during a time of tribulation, stayed righteous, were clothed in white. And read that verse for me, Bishop. Notice this.
For this reason, they are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple.
Somebody say day and night. Somebody say no breaks. Not just Sundays and Wednesdays. We got to serve God every day. Amen. Day and night. And notice this.
And he who sits on the throne will spread his tabernacle over them.
I love. And he who sits on the throne will. See, God doesn't dwell in temples made with hands. God has a movable tabernacle. Where regardless of where you are, when you surrender to serving him day and night, God's able to extend the boundaries of his tabernacle so it can cover you. And regardless of where you're at, you always have access to the throne of God and to the presence of God, because God is not confined to a physical location or to a building. He's confined to faith and somebody that believes in him, and he'll meet you right where you're at. It's a powerful, powerful principle. We serve a living God. Amen. Whose church is a living church. Amen. We don't dwell in a physical temple. God's temple is a movable temple. He can extend his tabernacle to where you are. That's powerful. Notice this.
They will hunger no more.
Somebody say, no more hunger. Notice this.
Nor thirst anymore.
No more thirst. That's natural desire. That's physical desire also. Because you understand, when hunger hits you, thirst hits you, it's an uncomfortable feeling. But there's going to come a day and time where you're not going to have to worry about natural things anymore. Amen? Thank God for it. Keep coming, Bishop. Notice this.
Nor will the sun beat down on them.
Nor will it be too hot. How many of you get irritated when you get hot? I know I feel like that. I thank God for the day he delivers me from that. Amen? Because when the sun beats down on you, you can get uncomfortable, get irritated. Amen? Thank God for setting us free. Keep coming. Notice this.
Nor any heat. For the Lamb in the center of the throne.
So you're not going to be hungry, not going to be thirsty. God's going to take care of all of those desires. And here's the reason why. How is God going to alleviate you from all of these things, from all of these symptoms we all have to deal with day in and day out? He's going to alleviate you from them for who? Somebody say the Lamb. For the Lamb, what, Bishop? Notice this.
In the center of the throne will be their shepherd.
Will be their shepherd. Here's what's going to set you free. The Lamb being your shepherd. Somebody say it's all about Jesus. When you surrender your life to allow Jesus to have his way in you, that's when you get delivered from these natural things. Notice this. For the Lamb who is in the center of the throne will do what, Bishop?
Will be their shepherd.
Uh-huh.
And will guide them to springs of the water of life.
And will guide them to springs of the water of life. Somebody say, that's all we need. To drink from that well of life. Amen. And the only way you can get there is Jesus. You can't get there any other way. That's the plan of God. You got to go through the Messiah. You got to allow the sheep who became the shepherd, amen, to be your chief shepherd and bishop of your soul and lead you to this fountain. And do what, Bishop?
And he will guide them to the springs of the water of life.
Uh-huh.
And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes.
And God will wipe away every... So what's the key to finding relief, finding deliverance, finding redemption, having tears wiped away, finding the spring? How do we get there? You got to give your life to Jesus. At the end of the day, saints, that's what it's all about. That's why Paul said to a Corinthian church that had all types of problems, all types of things going on, he said, I desire to hear nothing among you than Jesus Christ and him crucified. Because everywhere else in the world, you're going to talk about everything else. But when it comes to the people of God, when it comes to life, when it comes to situation, when it comes to problem, all of these things get alleviated when you simply turn to Jesus. Saints, Jesus is the answer. He said it himself, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. Saints, 2,000 years later, he's still the answer. The Messiah is still the answer, the key to leading us into this everlasting life. Every day we got to live it for Jesus, to Jesus, and allow him to lead us because he truly is the shepherd. You understand? He's the shepherd of this flock. He's the head of the body, the church, who was the firstborn from the dead, that we belong to Christ. That's what the book says. The book says, know ye not that ye are Christ and Christ is God's. God gave to Christ the church. For Christ said, Father, I've kept all that you've given me. Amen. Save one, the son of perdition, that the scriptures may be fulfilled. All the Father has is mine, Jesus said. You understand? You were a gift to the Messiah. God gave you to Christ because Christ was faithful and provided a way that you might be saved. So now God has given him power over all flesh. We're flesh, aren't we, saints? That means we belong to the Messiah. Amen. Somebody say shepherd. You understand? Jesus is our shepherd. Turn with me, if you would, to the book of Jeremiah 23. Jeremiah 23. Amen. Somebody say Jesus. Amen. Jeremiah 23, we'll start at verse 1 whenever everybody gets there.
Woe to the shepherds who are destroying and scattering the sheep of my pasture.
Woe to the shepherds who are destroying and scattering the what?
Sheep of my pasture.
You understand that for years, God's people were oppressed. God's people have been afflicted, still even unto this day. Amen? And they're shattered and scattered because they didn't have a true shepherd. Guess who fixes that problem? Amen. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
Declares the Lord.
Uh-huh.
Therefore, thus says the Lord God of Israel concerning the shepherds who are tending my people.
Uh-huh.
You have scattered my flock and driven them away and have not attended to them. Behold, I am about to attend to you for the evil of your deeds, declares the Lord.
Notice how harsh and swift God came upon those who were supposed to help keep his people in line. Amen. When you read through the Old Testament, the elders of Israel and the prophets and everybody that God has sent we're called to keep God's people in line. But many of the people who were appointed as rulers and shepherds over the city weren't doing justice to the people of God. They were instead using God's people as a source of gain, which happens to be the problem with the majority of Christianity today. Can I get a witness? Trying to capitalize off God's people. God didn't, look, that's why I thank God for Jesus. He ain't doing what's best for him. He's doing what's best for you. He went through everything he went through because it was what was best for you. He didn't go through it because he's profiting off your money or profiting off anything that you have to offer. He did it simply because he loves you and he desired to bring you back to the fold. Hallelujah. Notice this. Keep coming for me, Bishop.
Then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them.
Amen.
And bring them back to their pasture.
And what you're going to see is in this passage, I'll gather all my sheep, the remnant of my flock. I'll gather all them together. And what you're going to see here is all of this that's being talked about is a messianic prophecy. It's all leading up to the coming of the Messiah. Keep coming, Bishop. Notice this.
And they will be fruitful and multiply.
I'll bring all my seed back that were scattered because of false pastors. I'll bring all them back. They'll be fruitful and they'll multiply. Somebody say growth. Keep coming, Bishop. Notice this.
I will also raise up shepherds over them.
I will also raise up shepherds over them. Jeremiah talked a lot about shepherds. Did he not? He talked a lot about shepherds after my own heart that will feed and instruct you with knowledge and instruction. We got to earnestly be seeking in this day shepherds that are called by God to shepherd the people. Amen. We need real, genuine shepherds, not ones that are in it for their own personal gain, but ones that are in it because they're faithful to God and desiring to round up the flock that's been scattered and been wounded and been oppressed. Amen. Somebody say shepherds. Look, that's why we got to answer the call of God. When God's calling us to walk in this level, God's always trying to raise up shepherds because God needs laborers. There's plenty of broken people in the world. The harvest is white. The harvest is ready. God needs workers. God needs laborers. God needs shepherds. Amen. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
I will also raise up shepherds over them and they will tend them.
They will tend them. Amen. Notice this.
And they will not be afraid any longer, Hallelujah. Nor be terrified, Hallelujah. Nor will any be missing, declares the Lord.
Nor will any be, that's powerful. Yeah. Nor will any be missing. Look, when the shepherds start operating how they're supposed to operate, and the shepherds start answering the call, and everyone that God is calling to do his work answers the call and does it how he's calling them to do it, you wind up finding that none of the flock goes missing. That's powerful. Amen. Notice this.
Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord.
Behold, the days are coming. Now, here's where he's trying to lead up to here. That God's people have been under oppression, false pastors, all sorts of things for years and years. But now the day is coming. Read this for me, Bishop.
When I will raise up for David a righteous branch.
Uh-huh.
And he will reign as king and act wisely.
I will raise up from David a righteous what? And he will reign as. Now here's the thing. The problem with God's people, according to the context of the passage, is God's people were oppressed because they didn't have a shepherd. So now God's solution for them being shepherdless is to raise them up from the lineage of David a king. Ain't that what the scripture says? From the lineage of David, I will read that for me one more time, Bishop. Notice this.
Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he will reign as king.
I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he will reign as. But see, this is unique. You know why? Because before David was ever a king, how many of you understand David was not Saul's son? David wasn't born into kingship. What was David before he was ever a king? Amen. So now David, because of his heritage of being a shepherd, had more of a genuine love for God's people. It wasn't just about ruling over God's people. It was about helping and ministering to God's people to reunite them with God. So David's kingship went far beyond just him ruling. It had everything to do with him having a shepherd's heart, a man after God's own heart, and desiring God's people to know God. It was because of David's love for God that God promised David that he would, of his lineage, raise one up to sit on his throne that would be Messiah. Amen? Because of David's ability to be a shepherd. That's why God targeted the lineage of David, not just because God wanted a king, but God wanted a king who would be a shepherd. Read that verse for me, Bishop. Notice this.
Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he will reign as king and act wisely and do justice.
He will reign as king, act wisely, do justice. Notice this.
And righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved.
Amen.
And Israel will dwell securely.
Hallelujah.
And this is his name by which he will be called.
Amen.
The Lord, our righteousness.
This is his name by which he will be called. The Lord, all caps, our righteousness. How many of you understand the Lord is Yahweh in the Greek? Amen. The Hebrew letters Yad, He, Vav, He, Yahweh. And his name shall be called Yahweh, our righteousness. Now you understand that anytime you see messianic prophecies that are about what the Messiah would be called, these are not prophecies concerning his birth name, right? You understand that, like when the scripture said that he will be called Emmanuel, that wasn't a prophecy that Mary would name him Emmanuel, for she named him Yeshua. Amen? These are not prophecies concerning what his birth name would be, but these are prophecies that exemplify what his authority would be, how his character would be. When they talk about his name, it's not talking about we have a problem, especially as apostolics. Anytime you bring up the name, it's like, oh, goodness gracious, he came in his father's name. And this, we're trying to read like the physical or the birth name. Amen. We understand that he's talking about authority. The prophecy said he would be called Emmanuel, which is being interpreted as God with us. But his birth name was not Emmanuel, right? But you understand when Nicodemus went to him, Nicodemus said, Master, we know that thou art a teacher come from God because of the signs and the wonders you do. We know that God is with you. Amen? That by the life that Jesus witnessed and testified and the power of God that was demonstrated through him, you knew truly that God was with him. But because God was with him working those miracles, Israel had a reminder that God was with us. He hadn't forsaken us like the Jews thought, because it had been hundreds of years since they had had a prophet. Amen? So Christ was a reminder that God was still with Israel, God with us. That's the prophecy that was given concerning his name, concerning his authority. Same with this one. Prophecy concerning his name, his authority, that he would be Yahweh, our righteousness. He would literally be seen as the righteousness of God. How many of you understand that's exactly what Christ was? You do understand he was perfect. He lived above sin. No sin was found in him. No guile was found in him. He truly was the righteousness of Yahweh. That's what this passage is talking about. Amen? Give me Ezekiel 34, Bishop. I think Bishop posted something this week about this passage, and it had actually been on my heart when I saw it. I thought it was pretty unique. Amen? It's a wonderful passage. Somebody say a shepherd. See, God never wanted his people to continue to be scattered. It's the will of God that he starts rounding up his people from the four corners of the earth. Amen? And how is he doing? How is God rounding up the flock, saints? By Christ Jesus, the chief shepherd. That's what shepherds do. Shepherds round up the flock. That's why when you preach Jesus, the sheep, it does something to the spirit of the sheep. Amen? It's like a call to the spirit of the sheep, where they feel the pull to know God, They feel the pull to come back to God. You could be feeling overwhelmed. You could be feeling stressed. You could be feeling depressed. But then somebody starts preaching Jesus. And all of a sudden, it's like you hear the voice of the shepherd calling and reaching you and pulling you back, saying, come to the Father. Come to the Father. And you find that deliverance. You find that peace. You find that rest. Exactly what he was talking about in the book of Revelation. That's what happens. That's why we preach Jesus. Amen. He's a shepherd. He's rounding us up. For time's sake, I'm not going to read all of Ezekiel 34. But if any of you haven't done so, I want to encourage you. Read Ezekiel 34. It's a powerful passage, especially in light of the last days and in light of everything that's happening with religion, with church, all sorts of things. We're going to start with verse 22, though, this morning. Notice this. 34 and 22 in the book of Ezekiel, 34:22.
Therefore, I will deliver my flock, and they will no longer be a prey.
Now, the whole context of Ezekiel 34 is about how God's people have been oppressed by false shepherds. Amen? False shepherds have oppressed the flock of God. So now when you read through it, it's like the first 21 verses are talking about how false shepherds have done God's people wrong. And then you get to verse 22 and God comes with the deliverance. Amen? No, notice this. 22, read it for me, Bishop.
Therefore, I will deliver my flock,
uh-huh,
and they will no longer be a prey. And I will judge between one sheep and
uh-huh
another.
Therefore, I will deliver my flock, and they will no longer be a prey. How many of you understand God desires to set us free from the rule of false shepherds? God doesn't desire us, our lives, just to be ravaged and ruined by the lives of people that are in false doctrine, by the lives of people that are money hungry, that are greedy, that are trying to capitalize on our sincere faith in God. God desires to deliver us. That's why for anybody, I understand it may not apply to any of us in here, but if anybody hears this on YouTube, podcast, if you're sitting up in a church where you go to and you understand that the pastor is not feeding you truth, he's not feeding you the truth of God, the righteousness of God, he's only trying to keep you around for money or for attendance or for personal gain, you got to get out of there. You are not obligated by God to sit there and stay under that. You're obligated by God to go find somebody that you believe is genuinely serving God, a true shepherd that's trying to feed the flock of God according to the truth of God. Amen? That God desires to deliver his people from that oppression. It don't matter how many generations you got in a church. So many times people feel the pull to stay in a church because it's the family church. No such thing as a family church. My family started this church. I don't want the church your family started. I want the church Jesus started. Because the church Jesus started is the only church that exists. Everything else is not a true church. Upon this rock, I will build my church. Not upon the rock of your family name. Upon the rock of faith in the Son of God. Amen. God wants to deliver us. Look, God didn't call us to be taken advantage of. We're going to face persecution for faith. We're going to face persecution because of righteousness. But God didn't call us just to be sitting around as sitting ducks. He told us to be harmless as doves, but what? Wise as. You ain't gonna trick me. I'm not coming to bring the pain. I'm harmless as a dove. I'm not coming to hurt anybody. I'm not coming to fight. But I'm telling you what, God didn't call me to sit here and be stupid and just let you swindle me either. We got to be just as wise as serpents. I'm not out to deceive, but we got to be above the deceiver to where we're too wise to be deceived by people that are trying to walk in craftiness. God didn't call us to be stupid, spiritually dumb. God called us to walk in wisdom, walk in truth, be harmless, walk in peace, but not just sit there and let you crook me in the name of Jesus Christ. Can I get a witness? God wants to deliver us from the way and from the falsehood and from everything that's going on. God wants to deliver his people and bring his people back to truth, bring his people back to Christ, bring his people back to righteousness, round up the flock to allow everyone to serve God, free from that nonsense. Amen? Oh, keep reading for me, Bishop. Notice this. believe 22 still.
And they will no longer be a prey, and I will judge between one sheep and another.
And they will no longer be. That's what many. That's what much of church is now. We're not sheep for pastors. If we were, they would make time to talk to us. They would make time to see us. If they ain't got time for you, they're not your shepherd. They profit off you. They profit off you, but they ain't got time for you. That's called prey, not sheep. Amen? God wants to deliver his people from being prey. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
Then I will set over them one shepherd, my servant David.
But then I will set. David had been dead and gone. By the time Ezekiel was writing, can I get a witness? David had been dead and gone for years. Read that verse for me one more time, Bishop. Here's how God's going to deliver his people.
And I, the Lord, will be their God.
Uh-huh.
I'm sorry. You good? 23. Then I will set over them one shepherd.
Then I will set over them how many shepherds? This is the only one you need. If you get this one right and you start letting him lead you, he'll lead you to the other shepherds that need to be in your life. Amen. You just got to learn to follow the voice of this one. He'll get you right where you need to go. I'll give you one shepherd. And what, Bishop?
My servant David.
My servant who wasn't even living anymore. See, a lot of times when you read Jeremiah and when you read Ezekiel, you'll see messianic prophecies where they're referring to David being king or David being the shepherd. But in all actuality, they're talking about the Messiah, who would be a man from David's lineage, who would reign on David's throne, who also would be a man after God's own heart, who was a king and a shepherd and a priest and all of those things. Amen? Amen? He's talking about the Messiah. You understand, even David prophesied concerning himself, but the prophecy wasn't actually about him. It was about the Christ. Let me ask two real fast, Bishop. We'll come back to this. What verse are we on? 23. We'll come back to 23. Give me Acts 2 and 22 real fast, Bishop. Is everybody still following me this morning? Just talking about Jesus. Amen.
Men of Israel, listen to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs,
amen,
which God performed through him.
Which God performed. Hallelujah.
In your midst, just as you yourselves know, this man, delivered over by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God.
Before the foundation of the world. Amen. Before this man delivered over according to the foreknowledge and predetermination of God. Somebody say, before there was a world, there was a Christ. Amen. Keep coming for me, Bishop.
You nailed to a cross by the hands of godless men and put him to death.
Yep.
But God raised him up again,
putting
an end to the agony of death.
Amen.
Since it was impossible for him to be held in its power.
Since putting an end to the agony of death, because it was impossible for him to be held of its power. Goodness gracious. I mean, if there ever was a time to say amen, that would have been it. Amen? It were not possible for him to be holding of death. Death couldn't hold him. Show me that man. That death itself isn't even powerful enough to keep him down. You won't find him in any other religion. You won't find him in any other faith. You'll only find him believing in the biblical Messiah, Jesus Christ. Amen? Of Nazareth. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
For David says of him, I saw the Lord always in my presence, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken.
Amen.
Therefore, my heart was glad and my tongue exalted. Moreover, my flesh will also live in hope.
Amen.
Because you will not abandon my soul to Hades.
Now, notice, this is David talking about himself. Because you will not abandon my soul to Hades, nor what?
nor allow your Holy One to undergo decay.
Did David decay? Amen. Keep coming. Notice this.
You have made known to me the ways of life.
Uh-huh.
You will make me full of gladness with your presence.
Amen.
Brethren, I may confidently say to you regarding the patriarch David,
uh-huh,
that he both died and was buried.
And was? He both died and was? So who's this prophecy talking about? Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
And his tomb is with us to this day.
His tomb is even still with us to this very day. Notice this.
And so, because he was a prophet,
uh-huh,
and knew that God had sworn to him with an oath to seat one of his descendants on his throne.
Hallelujah.
He looked ahead and spoke of the resurrection of the Christ.
Hallelujah.
That he was neither abandoned to Hades,
uh-huh,
nor did his flesh suffer decay.
Hallelujah.
This Jesus God raised up again,
uh-huh,
to whom we are all witnesses.
Hallelujah.
Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God,
hallelujah,
and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured forth this which you both see and hear.
Hallelujah.
For it was not David who ascended into heaven,
hallelujah,
but he himself says, the Lord said to my Lord,
uh-huh,
sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet.
Hallelujah.
Therefore, let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified.
Go ahead and give Jesus a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your faithfulness. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your faithfulness. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise be unto you, Lamb of God. Praise be unto you, Lamb of God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So you see, when David, or the prophecies came forth concerning David, the actual fulfillment of the prophecies were referring to his offspring. Amen? The root and the offspring of David, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Amen? Ezekiel 34 and 23. Is everybody still with me this morning? How many of you thank God for Jesus? Hallelujah. I thank God for Jesus.
Then I will set over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will feed them.
Uh-huh. I will set over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will what? How many of you understand this talk about Christ Jesus? Keep coming for me. Notice this.
He will feed them himself,
uh-huh,
and be their shepherd.
He'll deal with you. All of you. How many of you understand Jesus said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone will open, I will come into him and sup with him. Jesus is knocking on the door, trying to be our shepherd, trying to feed us with whatever we need to lead us into green pastures, to lead us to the river of everlasting life, to lead us to that place where there are no more tears. We got to surrender to the leading of Jesus Christ, for he truly is the chief shepherd, saints. Notice this.
And I, the Lord, will be their God.
Uh-huh.
And my servant David will be prince among them.
Hallelujah.
I, the Lord.
Christ. Amen. Notice this.
I, the Lord, have spoken.
Uh-huh.
I will make a covenant of peace with them and eliminate harmful beasts from the land so that they may live securely in the wilderness and sleep in the woods.
Amen.
I will make them and the places around my heel a blessing.
Hallelujah.
And I will cause showers to come down in their season. They will be showers of blessing.
They will be showers of blessing. You understand? Let me tell you. You understand God wants to bless us. Yeah. That don't mean he wants to give us a Rolls Royce Bentley. But you understand God wants to provide for his people. God ain't trying to leave us and forsake us. Can I get a witness? I'm not saying he's going to give us mansions and make us we're kings. And no, that's not. God, Christ never taught that. Scriptures never taught that. But the scriptures always taught that God would be faithful, God would provide, and God would bless you, and God would give you this day your daily bread. Amen? Amen? God's always going to provide for his people. We just got to keep on living righteous and allow God to do what it is that he does. Because he's faithful. Amen? Amen? Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
Also, the tree of the field will yield its fruit, and the earth will yield its increase, and they will be secure on their land.
Amen.
Then they will know that I am the Lord, when I have broken the bars of their yoke and have delivered them from the hand of those who enslaved them.
Hallelujah.
They will no longer be a prey to the nations, and the beast of the earth will not devour them.
Amen.
But they will live securely, and no one will make them afraid.
Hallelujah.
I will establish for them a renowned planting place, and they will not again be victims of famine in the land, and they will not endure the insults of the nations anymore. Then they will know that I, the Lord their God, am with them, and that they, the house of Israel, are my people, declares the Lord God. As for you, my sheep, the sheep of my pasture, you are men, and I am your God, declares the Lord God.
Hallelujah. You notice how the language all throughout that is very similar to the language of Revelation, the first passage we read, concerning God and the shepherd that would lead you and guide you and take care of you, and that God will be your God. That, I thank God for providing for us, for leading us, for securing us, for keeping us through his son Jesus. Amen. You understand that God is keeping us. That's why the scripture said we're preserved in Jesus Christ. God is preserving us through his son, Christ Jesus. God's ministering us through his son, Christ Jesus. That's why everything we do, we got to come to God through Jesus. Because he's the mediator between God and man. The man, Christ Jesus. He's how we get to God, and he's how God gets to us. I thank God for the Lord Jesus Christ. Do we got time? John 10? Can we go to John 10 and then I'm through? Bishop's already read out like 5 chapters, though. John 10, amen? And then we'll see what God wants to do. John 10, verse 1. How many of you thank God for Jesus? But listen, we got to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. He's the author and finisher of our faith, amen? You can't finish this race if you're not focused on Christ. You can't finish this race when you're not focused on Christ. Christ is going to get you to the finish line. Christ is going to get you through and get you exactly where you need to go. We got to stay focused on Jesus, the Messiah. Amen? John 10 and verse 1. Notice this.
Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter by the door into the fold of the sheep, but climbs up some other way, he is a thief and a robber.
If you try to get into the fold that the flock is in, and you're not going through the door, you're a thief. You can't get in any other way. There's only one way in. You got to go through the what? You got to go through the door. Amen? If you drive by a house and you see somebody outside climbing through the window, what are you going to think? That they live there? Amen? You going to think that they live there? I understand. Sometimes you lock your keys out. You got to do what you got to do. I've been there. But I'm just saying to the person driving by, amen, if you got the keys, you just go on in through the normal door. That's religion. For all people that don't have the keys on how to get into the barn, they got to come up with other ways, alternate routes to try and get. But the only way, if you want to get in this barn, you got to go through the door. Amen? Ain't but one way to get in. Through Christ and through how Christ said to get in. You got to be born of the water and of the Spirit. Amen? Baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You got to go through Christ Jesus. Notice this. Keep coming for me, Bishop.
But he who enters by the door is a shepherd of the sheep.
So how does the shepherd get into the fold? He goes in through the door. So now if you want to get into the fold, you got to go in the same way Jesus went in. You know Jesus went to the water. Well, and when he arose, they saw the Spirit descending upon him. And we just read in Acts 2 that he had received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost. So he, just like us, had to be born of water and of the Spirit. That's why he was the firstborn of many brethren. The same way the shepherd goes in to get into the fold, you got to go in that same way. He went in through the door, you got to go in through the door. Now notice this. Notice what he says now.
To him, the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice.
Amen.
And he calls his own sheep by name.
Hallelujah.
And leads them out.
How many of you understand? He knows you. If you go to a church and the pastor don't know your name, you need to find a new church. Because the scriptures themselves in the book of Philippians say, greet every saint by name that is in Christ Jesus. If you go to a church and nobody knows your name, you need to find a new church. I get, you know, nobody knows your name the first time, maybe first couple times. But after you've been going there for a while and nobody knows your name, it's time, hey, I want to think about finding a new place to go. Because Jesus knows your name. Shepherds know the name of the sheep. Your pastor don't know your name, he ain't your shepherd. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
To him the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out.
Amen.
When he puts forth all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice.
Hallelujah. You understand? That's your relationship with Christ. This is how it works. He goes in. He calls your name. How many of you understand when Christ initially called you, you answered the call? And you understand he's still dealing with you. He's going out ahead of you, trying to lead you to where you need to go. And he's going to be doing that until he leads you to the day where he says, well done, my good and faithful servant. You just got to keep following his voice because he's going to get you where you need to go, saints. That goes for each and every one of us. We have to keep Jesus at the forefront of everything we do. Amen? He's going to get us there. He's going to get us there, saints. Notice this.
A stranger, they simply will not follow.
A stranger, they simply, it is what it is. They're not going after the voice of someone that's posing as a shepherd and doesn't sound like Jesus. That comes back to the be harmless as doves, but be what? You don't sound like Jesus. I'm not following you. That's why you always teach your kids from a young age, stay away from strangers. Some stranger tries to call you. That's not your parent. I don't care what they say. They might say that they're your daddy. If they don't look like daddy and they don't sound like daddy, they're not your daddy, and you better not go anywhere near them. Same goes for the sheep. Somebody trying to pose as Christ, pose as a Christian, pose as doing the will of God, but they don't sound like and they don't look like holiness, you got to go the other way. Because they ain't going to take you anywhere where Jesus is. Amen? Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
A stranger, they simply will not follow, but will flee from him. Because they do not know the voice of strangers.
Because they do not know. Man. Keep coming for me. I'm almost finished.
This figure of speech Jesus spoke to them, but they did not understand what those things were which he had been saying to them. So Jesus said to them again, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep.
Now look, first he said, if you don't go in through the door, you're going in the other way, you're a thief and a robber. And then he said, the shepherd goes in through the door. So he starts off by saying he's the shepherd and that he himself went through the door, right, to get into the fold. Because there's only one way to get into the fold. Then later in the parable, he didn't just say he was the shepherd that went through the door. He now changed his language and he said, I'm not only the shepherd that went through the door, I'm the actual door itself. Hallelujah. He didn't just go through the door. He is the door. He's not just the sheep that's part of the flock. He's the shepherd who leads the flock. Saints, he's just like us. A man just like you, just like me, same blood just like you, just like me, endured temptation just like you, just like me, live holy, just what we're aspiring to be. That's why we follow Christ, because he already is where we're trying to get and already went through everything we have to go through. He'll get you there. Amen. Because he did it himself. He'll get you there, saints. Keep coming for me, Bishop.
All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them.
Amen.
I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he will be saved.
Hallelujah.
And will go in and out and find pasture.
Hallelujah.
The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy.
Mm-hmm.
I came that they might have life and have it abundantly.
Hallelujah.
I am the good shepherd.
Amen.
The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep.
The good shepherd dies for those he loves. Hallelujah. Notice this.
He who is a hired hand and is not a shepherd, who is not the owner of the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees.
Saves himself. Jesus didn't save himself so you could be lost. He lost himself so you could be saved. That's love. That's a true shepherd, a good shepherd. Notice this.
And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand.
Hired hand. He ain't working for love. He's working for money. Amen. That's the difference between the true shepherd and false shepherds. Notice this.
And is not concerned about the sheep.
Uh-huh.
I am the good shepherd, and I know my own, and my own know me. Even as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep.
Hallelujah.
I have other sheep which are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will hear my voice, and they will become one flock with one shepherd.
Hallelujah. Talking about the Gentiles. Christ would bring them all together, Jews, Gentiles, and there'd be one flock with one shepherd. Prophesied in Ezekiel about that one shepherd. Amen. Keep coming. Notice this. I'm about finished.
For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life so that I may take it again. No one has taken it away from me, but I lay it down on my own initiative. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This commandment I received from my Father.
This commandment, this authority have I received of my Father. The power to lay your life down and raise yourself back up from the dead was a power that he received from who? You understand, everything Christ has, he got it from God. He said all power in heaven and earth was given unto me. He had it because God gave it to him. That's true biblical teaching right there. Saints, oh man. Everything that's been said today, from when Elder Waldron started to everything I've said, let me sum it up for you. Let's stay focused on Jesus. Jesus is what he wants to lead us. He wants to continue to guide us. He wants to help us. He wants to heal us. He wants to get us where we need to go. We got to keep serving God. We got to keep walking by faith. And we got to keep allowing Christ Jesus to do his will in our life, saints. Because if we trust and obey his voice, we're going to make it, saints. We're going to make it. Let's stand this morning in appreciation for the Lord Jesus Christ today. Let's stand this morning in genuine appreciation today. With genuine thanksgiving, won't you just give the Lamb of God a praise? Father, we thank you. We thank you for your perfect plan. We thank you for your perfect will. We thank you for your perfect way. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, that laid down his life. That good shepherd that laid down his life. That was given all power in heaven and in earth. That was given the authority to lay down his life, but to also take it up again. That you, Christ, might live forevermore, conquering death, conquering hell, conquering the grave, and giving us life. We thank you for the newness of life that we find in you, Christ. We thank you for that newness of life, for truly the day will come where we hear your voice from the grave, that will arise unto the resurrection of life. God, we thank you for that life which can only be found in your Son, Jesus. Hallelujah. Blessing and honor and majesty, dominion and power be unto God who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb, both now and forevermore. God, we're grateful. Grateful today, God. I'm grateful for your son, Jesus, today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. If you're truly grateful for Jesus, the Son of God, and all he's done for you, won't you give him another hand clap of praise this morning?
Tell somebody, I thank God for sending the good shepherd. The good shepherd. Amen. Righteous, holy, perfect in every way. He overcome temptation, so he's shown us how to overcome it as well. May that same mind be in us which was in Christ Jesus to please God in all things. Would you pray that with me right now before we're dismissed? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word that's gone forth this morning. And we thank you that you have provided for us the good shepherd, your son, Christ Jesus our Lord, to show us the way. And we receive him as the door into your sheepfold. And we're not trying to come any other way, for they that come unto you must come by your son, he whom you've chosen. We thank you for Jesus. Teach us to be like him, Father, in all things, that we may please you, O God, even as Christ Jesus pleased you in all that he did. May that be our lives as well. And we ask this in faith, in the name, in the authority that our Lord Jesus Christ has given unto us to approach you, Father. We ask all these things. And we shall be kept by your grace and by your spirit in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. It's all about him, not us. It's about him. It's all about Jesus. Tell that to somebody. Testify that. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. Amen. Keep that on your hearts and minds. Meditate on that as you leave today. That it's all about Jesus. And how we can become more like him. How we can follow in his footsteps and his example in all things. Amen. He's the shepherd. We're the sheep. We got to follow him. Amen. Grace and peace to you all. For those of you who need prayer, please make your way to the front. For those who wish to give cheerfully and willingly, you can do so at the back in the box, or somebody will be waiting on you. Grace and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the Father, in truth and in love. Amen. You're dismissed.